Hello and welcome back everyone to the OPL. We've got our last match of the evening here as Avant take on Immunity. I am Julian Page-Duncar. This is Christopher Papasmithy-Smith. And what a last game we just had.
I step away from a game one time, Julian, and out comes the swing.
Yeah, and unsurprisingly, MVP of that game did in fact go to IM Cheese there for a magnificent performance on his trademark swing. What a game to watch, and a big breakout game for him as well.
And what I want to revisit is actually something Atlas said. Cheese is new on this lineup. For them to pick such a synergistic comp for Swain, the Sivir-Swain synergy, getting in there with all the birds running, in position to hit all the CC, slow people down, get the damage down. And he's got the Swain mechanics, he's always had them. Wonderful performance.
Yeah, just again, very smart drafting for Immunity, and we'll see if they can continue that here. A good win there will put them definitely with some momentum here in this one. It is best of ones, but Immunity have always been a momentum-based team, so they're going to feel very good coming in here. And unfortunately for Avant-Garde, the opposite is true here. They're actually on the verge of potentially going 0-4 in their first 2 weeks of OPL. And at that point, it's a losing streak. That's not where they want to be at all.
Absolutely. For a seeded team to go 0-4 does raise a lot of alarm bells right there. We've got interesting matchups across the board, but you have to say that jungle matchup's the really interesting one. Chelby against Zahi.
Yeah, and I mentioned it actually, I think, in the last game, but Chelby and Zahi have very similar playstyles. They're both playing high-pressure, aggressive early-game junglers, and the pick here between these two is absolutely Lee Sin. They are big Lee Sin players, and if it's not banned or blocked away in some capacity, I'd be very surprised.
Yeah, it's the Lee Sin and Vi were actually the two picks for both of them last week, and it was the Lee Sin that definitely led the way. Both of them looked a little bit uncomfortable on that Vi pick. And also, I mean, the synergy doesn't end there. Both of them, of course, had a very similar schedules. Both of them playing Rich Gang last week. Avant-Garde couldn't get over the line against them, but Immunity handing that Rich Gang upstart team their first loss. Now you have to say again, a run of momentum, two wins in the pocket right here, starting to build up synergy between the new lineup. It's looking good for Immunity.
Yeah, and Avant, of course, still playing with the sub result. Porky isn't able to play, it seems, in the first 2 weeks. Be interesting to see when he does come back how that affects him. But right now, Avant, maybe with an arguably weakened lineup, still want to make sure they can get it big. And for Avant as well, it's not just the sub that's affecting him potentially. They're still kind of getting used to their new bottom lane as well.
Yeah, they just need to try and pull something in the early game. They need to put Immunity outside their comfort zone. The comfort zone, whether it's the comp, whether it's that early snowball, that's where Immunity really come up clutch. If you can throw them off early game, if you can really either out-rotate them or pull off some smart moves in the early game, you definitely have a shot against them on any day.
Yes, we are in champs like now as well. Be very curious to see how this draft develops. But Immunity are on the blue side here. Avant over on the red, and Immunity still respecting the pick. Going to ban out Nidalee, and we've got a Jarvan ban there for Avant.
See, I wouldn't have wanted to see the Nidalee out a second time from Chelby, not because he can't play it. It's just he needs to play the pressure jungler this game. He needs to get on the nerves of Immunity here, get on top of Zahi, and try and snowball for his team. And Nidalee, you know, the sort of champion that can be easily corralled in the early game with the lane swap, with the rotational play we saw out of their opponents last time here. So go for the high-pressure champion. Really contest that Lee Sin pick, because that might be really the key to getting a victory here for Avant.
Yeah, Lee Sin's still available here as well. We've got LeBlanc, the second man there for Immunity. Avant-Garde follow through with Janna. And funny you mentioned Nidalee as a jungler. Very old-school Kansas City champion as well, but probably not where we were going to see it.
Yeah, I mean, if we're going to talk Kansas City champions, Nidalee's up there, but Kassadin's the number one. And the question would be, do you pull out the Kassadin after that particular performance we saw out of Swain? Swain's a wonderful counter pick to Kassadin, always has been. So for it to come through at the last pick right there, it was just really exciting and spicy to see. But the Janna ban's worth mentioning here, of course. Sudden Fear definitely showed some disrespect during the week. They were happy to leave it up. And it was gleefully taken by Tiga and played it with aplomb. The replay showed off some of the excellent Janna mechanics there. So smart to ban it away, I think. And for Tiga to be commanding a disengage support ban, massive for his team.
Yeah, things looking good for Tiga in there, as we do have the last ban, Gnar there for Immunity. Avant-Garde have gone with the Kassadin, so respecting the power of their pick, not just because it's a Kansas City champion, because they don't want to give it over to Immunity. And now, first pick open, Lissandra actually left open. It's probably the most notable champion left.
Yeah, Lissandra, I mean, I'm sure JK Smithy can take that in the top. He has a lot of good answers to Lissandra, so maybe they'll go for something else. I'm sure he'd opt into that Renekton versus Lissandra matchup again, so maybe not going to show the priority there, but the flex pick of Sandra is always so strong. Of course, one champion's got through. It's still 5.2. This is full power rework Ahri here. Can't go past that.
Yeah, really strong champion. And as we mentioned in the last series that Immunity played, Cheese has been on a roll, like a lot of players in solo queue that are mid lane players on this particular Ahri. And no surprises there. They're going to pick it up as their first.
Yeah, did my research today. Saw 7 straight games of solo queue Ahri. And I was like, yep, definitely going to pick that up if it's available.
Yeah, and looks like a pretty curious over here from Avant, but they're going to see what they want to go for. Interesting to see Shelby with the lease in open. That's presumably where he wants to go, but maybe he wants to try something a little bit different. We talk about Shelby. He's a big barometer for this avant-garde team. He has to get going in some capacity. And yes, traditionally he was known for aggression, but he has also been able to play a bit more measured as well. That was a key point in their win in the regional final last year. But no matter what happens, if it's a controlled jungler or an aggressive jungler, Shelby needs to make stuff happen early.
And we obviously saw a massive Rek'Sai performance come out from Carbon, but that was in a situation where he didn't even really need to show lane presence. He was almost an auxiliary damage threat, going the second item Trinity Force, really able to go. And it was a bit of a blowout game, so we can't take too much away about Rek'Sai right there. Rek'Sai has been nerfed on this 5.2 patch. I'm still, you know, trying to really work out where she falls on the top tier jungle pick. She's certainly relevant. Her global pressure is so, so strong right here. And for Shelby to opt into it tells me that he obviously values her above some of those other more traditional jungle picks.
Yeah, and Shelby is going to go for it here, like you mentioned. I love the Thresh pick here as well, sort of blocking that away from T-Gun. But Immunity picking very confidently here in this game. Morgana going to be another classic T-Gun supporter, although not quite as the Blitzcrank or the Alistar. And I like this pick again. Comfort for JK Smithy going with Aurelia.
Yeah, I mean, he's an Aurelia player for a long time right here. Again, a lot of those tanky picks, he picks up with a lot of confidence. He doesn't seem to be worried about the Lissandra potentially coming out in the top lane right here. Again, I mean, Aurelia can always be relevant in any matchup, but early lock in and then force them to choose one of their solo lanes here, letting them know that Aurelia is not going to be available.
Yeah, and Aurelia, just such a strong early pick in a draft. She just feels so safe. I mean, yeah, you can struggle in certain parts of a matchup, but kind of once you get going, because like once you have level 9 and a Phage, things just look very, very easy.
And it wasn't Aurelia that was the source of the problems for Sudden Fear in the last series against Amir. The game was kind of played around top lane, although JK Smithy had some very nice ultimates towards the end of that game, so definitely no reflection of Aurelia as a champion. Still very, very strong.
Yeah, so last seconds ticking down now for Avant-Garde, and they are going to go in for what I guess actually now is a solo lane Lulu with the Thresher already. So Lulu potentially for Kensti or Bag Amlo, and Sivir there for Mizzou. Something a bit different from him, actually.
I mean, you don't really want to opt into a Lulu-Aurelia matchup, but it's okay. It's more a case of they were just unsure what they were going to see in the mid lane. They've kind of gone for the flex pick here and said, right, okay, if it's going to be a really strong assassin coming out from Cheese, well, of course, it's going to be the Ahri, so it could be just the lane clear in the mid lane. It's not really going to compete in terms of damage against Ahri, but it'll be respectable. But they have that flexible pick at least.
I'm very amazed that Lee Sin might even drop through a draft here in a game where we have both Zai and Shelby playing in it. So we'll have to see. Of course, Team Unity do have a bit more time. We've got a Hover of Pantheon right now, but still lots of picks here to come for Immunity. I do like the Lulu against Ahri. It just feels very safe, and that would make a bit more sense here for the Immunity lineup, but we'll give them a bit more time to sort it out.
I mean, if they do go with that mid Lulu, it makes sense given the power of Ahri in this patch. It can match the wave clear right there, stop the roam just from sheer turret pushing, but they need some carry pressure from the top. Man, they've got the Sivir right here to do relevant damage in the late game, but isn't a hyper carry per se. They need something that can stand up to Aurelia, but also provide a strong second threat, and the champ would do it.
He would indeed, and a big chance for Immunity on their side as well. Hovered the Corki for a second, but going for Jinx actually as the AD carry, and it is going to be Zahe's Lee Sin. So does eventually pick it up, decides it's what he wants, and champ not here yet. I mean, it's interesting to note that Lissandra's still open, but as you mentioned, wouldn't really fit what would then be a very low damage comp.
I mean, Lissandra's more about the CC. Some respectable burst in the mid game, but definitely not a big late game damage threat. I think it has to be Jax. I mean, he can opt into what is, on some level, a skill matchup against Aurelia. With the recent buffs to Jax, his itemization against Aurelia is actually quite relevant. If you go Trinity Force into a Frozen Heart, for example, there's so much cooldown reduction on that now, lower cooldown Counter-Strike, that you can really match the cooldown of the Hiten style right there and start to get favorable trades going. They're deciding between a lot of options, but I think Jax, it's a skill matchup. It's an exciting one. We'll have to watch up the top lane, but impressive for them to put so much pressure on a sub right here. Picking up the Jax is bad game, lol. He's going to be a cornerstone to a victory for Avant if they're able to pick one up here.
Yeah, again, we talked about Immunity doing it sort of in the last game, giving Cheese the high damage threat in mid to compensate for the tankier top lane and the low-ish damage of Sivir, especially moving into the late game. Very similar feel here for Avant, you have to think. And Jax does a lot of work in the late game, but he has to get there. And like you mentioned, it is the sub player there.
And it is a no-escape AD carry against Jax. If Jax gets on top of Jinx, she dies instantly. There's nothing she can do with all the potential of, say, the Blade of the Ruin King in the late game or a Randuin's to slow her down. If he gets in melee range, there's nothing Jinx can do. So again, a lot on Avant to build up this Jax. Not often we talk about building up the top laner as a strategy. Usually it's building up an AD carry, support the AD carry comps. But if they can baby Jax through this early game phase, pick up that Trinity Force at a good clip, work his way towards tanky items. Late game Jax is always a terror.
Yeah, it's funny because we're kind of moving towards maybe a fairly explosive mid game, but maybe a quite early game. But we'd still like to know over on Twitter, guys, who's going to get first blood in this game? We'd love to hear your thoughts. Use the hashtag AVFB or IMFB and getting your predictions for that first blood.
Yeah, I mean, personally, I'm going to say it's probably going to be the Ahri just because of how strong Ahri is right now. I worry for the 2v2 of this Lulu Lee Sin lane if we ever see a skirmish coming in with the Lee Sin coming in on this Rek'Sai Lulu mid lane skirmish, but see what the viewers have to say.
I feel like the bottom lane matchup's sort of interesting here as well, because we saw Corki versus Sivir, and that's a bit awkward on the Corki side for a number of reasons, but this is a matchup we're starting to see a little bit more now, where a lot of players, whether it's right or wrong, we don't really know yet, but they are opting to take Jinx against Sivir quite a few times.
Yeah, they're trying to bring Jinx back. I mean, Jinx versus Sivir in lane, it definitely goes towards Jinx's favor, especially as the game goes on. In the very early levels, can struggle with trades, but there's lots of interesting little mechanics about that matchup. I mean, the one thing I've observed is that if you're trading with a Sivir, Sivir, because of her 500 auto attack range, has to stand in the minion line when she's autoing. That's just how the range works in lane. So if you're able to get a rocket on her, you can push the wave and harass the Sivir with the same auto. Like, you're using a 20 mana auto there really, really efficiently to push and trade. And over levels, especially once the BF sword comes out, Jinx can start matching the wave clear that Sivir has and really start to push the advantage. And if you ever let Jinx have a safe laning phase, Jax notwithstanding, she'll be very powerful in the late game.
Yeah, I believe it's non-spell shieldable either, that rocket harass.
It's just an auto attack, just like the Draven Q, for example.
Yeah, which of course another popular pick against Sivir. Didn't see it here. Love to see Tallywacker playing out from Legacy earlier today. That was a treat to watch. But our last game here for round two, day one of the OPL. Of course, there'll be day two coming up, but a big game for both these teams. Avant would love to start crawling out of the hole that they're kind of digging themselves into with the first three losses already here in Immunity. They're going to hopefully ride that momentum to another victory.
Yeah, and look, Immunity 2-1, they've definitely rode themselves into competition of these top spaces right here. Of course, we already have the 3-1 coming through for Legacy, so they're looking to match Legacy's win ratio, at least at the end of this third day of play right here. They've got a very strong team comp, and they've got a definite goal, which is to keep this Jax down. Jax, unfortunately, in some situations, feels a bit like a Nasus in terms of the fact that if you can deny that farm, if you can stop him getting to that first big item, the game can kind of be played around Jax, and he's never really the champ that we know he can be in late game. But the late game is always a relative term. If you never get to that stage, it's not very relevant.
Yeah, and I think, again, going back to the jungle matchup here, Chelby going for a bit more of a controlled jungle Rek'Sai, though does sort of tread the line interestingly. It's not quite Nunu, not quite Jarvan, but maybe sits somewhere in the middle towards the control spectrum. Zai, though, big comfort pick here again, and a big aggressive jungler. Just getting Lee Sin, I think, last pick for their draft.
Yeah, I mean, when we look back last week, Zai really struggled on the Vi pick. Couldn't make things happen, was caught out in rotations in the jungle, and was basically exploited for his team right there in a game where, to be fair, every Immunity lane did struggle. Once he was able to take out that Lee Sin, and then we saw the Jarvan last game, those aggressive skirmishing junglers, that's where his confidence lies. He's always been that kind of player. This is definitely his game to shine. It's his game to be proactive. And Rek'Sai, always going to be more likely to be reactionary, always going to focus on farming her camps and then using that global ultimate to be relevant in terms of skirmishes. So, I mean, I'd give Zahi the advantage here. Whether he can use it in the early game or not remains to be seen.
Yeah, pretty curious about this mid lane here as well, actually, because obviously Kensti probably opting into a counter pick, just trying to make the matchup neutral there against Ahri. And we talk about Ahri on this fetch especially. Just silly. Silly powerful.
I mean, once they added that speed boost to her Q, it just gave her basically an escape before 6. And, like, 6 was the time when you were like, all right, I don't want to gank this Ahri. She can't lock her down without a Vi or something that can really get on top of her. Now she has a slow. It's basically, she can use an offensive ability, a harass ability, to effectively dodge any projectile in the game with that huge burst of move speed. So it's so hard to get on top of her. And we only really see Lulu in competitive play in mid lane these days against those assassins that you really respect. For example, we'll see people bring out Lulu against a LeBlanc if they don't have another counter pick or there's been certain bans in a game. So it shows you how respected this Ahri pick is right now, that you have to go for that champion that is never going to be a huge damage threat. That's just going to look to clear waves and just remove some pressure from the rest of our team.
Yeah, so we are looking to get into our next game here and our last game of the evening, and we're on to the Rift. Immunity versus Avant. Immunity looking to ride the wave and go 2-0 this week, and Avant trying not to go 0-2.
Yeah, and we've got the Lulu mid lane that we've been talking about, the champ in the top lane. We can all imagine that late game Jax jumping in there, the Lulu ultimate coming through, and the champ living up to his name, but there's a lot of game to go till then, and it's going to be very difficult to get this Jax through the laning phase.
Yeah, kind of like the insurance policy there as well with Uberbrew on a bit more of a late game carry. Certainly something a champion is very comfortable on, and again, Immunity are all about their comfort picks here. Draft looking very solid. I feel like Ozai actually going to get aggressive. Just really kicking Kensi in the back there. And that little Yordle, I think that's 40 AP at level 1. Not a whole lot in the armor scale, though.
No, not a whole lot in the armor scale, because Lee Sin's early game damage is always where he really starts to accentuate half health with just one rotation of the Q. Makes Kensi think twice about putting down a ward.
Yeah, perhaps importantly as well, very aggressive runes for these mid laners, by the way. Cheese also has 40 FP, and none of them have any magic resist.
It's why we saw the LeBlanc renaissance to some degree, is once Athenes fell out of the meta, and people were so insistent on running those AP per level blues, 30 magic resistant against a LeBlanc is just no fun for the enemy laner right here. So we often do see the health per level yellows, the AP per level blues, that's pretty standard. But it does mean that the damage trades in the early game just stick so much more than they used to.
Yeah, and I think that's going to be kind of a curious poke battle potentially there in the mid laners. Avant going to start up there. Grump in the blue side of the jungle. Zahe, Uberbro, and Tegun will team up for Krugs into red buff. And they're going to start on the same side of the jungle, these junglers. So they'll end up towards the top, and we are going to break out into standard lanes.
It'll be interesting to see how hard Avant push in the bot lane. Obviously, they have a Sivir versus Jinx matchup. So in the early levels, especially before any flat AD comes out, they'll have the pushing advantage, but they're against what should be a higher pressure skirmish jungler in Lee Sin right here. They don't expect too much early babysitting from the Rek'Sai. Rek'Sai usually focused on farming her camps in the early game right here, so at least starting with a very, very strong push.
Yeah, back in low as well. Did the Raptor camp. He's going to look to teleport it team dot towards the top. Buys a couple of extra pots, including a mana one. And he's going to start with a bit of an experience lead there.
Yeah, this is a start we see very common with both Jax and Maokai. If you can put down those saplings, or with Jax, you can just activate the Counter-Strike. You can get a very fast level 2 and often lose out on very minimal experience. So a significant experience advantage in the top lane.
Yeah, things starting off well. Back in low, maybe flexing his muscles in a champion. Gets a very good level 2 trade there with JK Smithy. Aurelia forced to run very far away, does turn around for a nice hit, and that was very aware play there from JK Smithy.
It looks like he's about half a level ahead in terms of experience, so obviously paying off on that early camp, and in the bottom lane, the pushing continues.
Yeah, I get always interesting to see, especially in the early levels, how much you can trim a wave against a Zero. It doesn't happen too often, but if you can keep the wave somewhere that's not under your turret, you're usually doing pretty well against Zero.
Yeah, and the Jinx outscan that we've spoken about will definitely become a thing once the BF sword comes in. So I do like the confident Jinx pick, and this is a champion that Uberbro always tried to bring to competitor. Obviously fell out of the meta a little bit in the last 3 or 4 months, especially with Lucian being so oppressive in the bottom lane, but any chance to bring out those hyper carries, that's where Uberbro is happy.
Yeah, I love that aggressive part thing there by Chelby as well. You saw him just take out the Scuttercrop there in towards basically Immunity's top side of the jungle where Zahi ended up. So it's not really counter-jungling, takes me more of some neutral control, but it is good that Chelby is able to get a little bit of a lead, especially if he wants to farm more in this Rek'Sai.
Absolutely, and you're basically farming a camp. They're getting a nice burst of gold and relieving pressures on your lane. So it's a bit like Nunu's playstyle was all about countering the enemy jungler. If you can pick up that Scuttlecrab with no real impact on your jungle route, why not do it?
Yeah, so smart parting there from Chelby. Zaya will have the Scuttlecrab on that side. Stolen away from him, but he's going to go into his Raptor camp now. We've got the Trailblazers actually up for both.
Yeah, it makes sense. I mean, obviously you can change to the Chilling Smite, or I mean, the Skirmish's Saber's kind of been the order of the day. You can switch to either of those for free later, so it makes sense on your first buy. Pick up the Ranger's Trailblazer. Get yourself closer to that level 6 power spike and then swap as you need.
Yeah, I wonder if that means Zahi wants to play a little less aggressive than he might otherwise here. But bottom lane, going very well now for Immunity. They're able to push in pretty aggressively using the pull there, plus the rockets and the minigun there for Jinx. And this is the issue. If Mazui can't get a foothold in this lane as Sivir, Jinx really starts to push you around.
Yeah, and you have to be really on point to use the spell shield right there, but in mid lane at least, it looks like we've got a gank.
Yeah, Cheese could be in trouble there. Chelby doing a lot of damage there. Cheese will run away. That Q, this makes it look so easy.
Yeah, you just open up so much space, but actually, can go back in.
Yeah, good moves there. Cheese actually could be in trouble, but first blood goes to Ari. Zahi now going to go in there. Does actually flash forward. Good knock up there for Chelby. Trying to block the Q. Kensi dodges it, though, and a very smart escape there as well.
Heroic body block coming through from Chelby to save his carry right there. Kensi lives to fight another day. Avant have the first advantage.
And a good bit of pressure there from Chelby. We didn't expect him to get too progressive on the Rek'Sai, but setting up a very nice gank. Cheese, we talk about his aggressive tendencies. He paid there as Ahri versus Lulu.
And that's always where Rek'Sai looks best, is when you can get that early little snowball, then return to your jungle, power farm your camps. Once you hit 6, the pressure's always equalized with that neural network that'll inevitably be down. Look at the top side of the map, already plenty of tunnels to port to.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that it's kind of funny to me that we talk about Rexha being a control champion. Not the same, again, not the same as Nunu, but for me, that neural network is so interesting because you get almost double the reward from power farming your camps.
Absolutely, and it kind of puts the pressure on the enemy jungler to try and invade to just cancel out the neural network, which is annoying, right? It takes time. You get granted vision as you do it. It's not usually a viable thing. The jungle matchup's not usually lopsided enough that you can take out that neural network. So at least in getting to camps in her own jungle and close to her own lanes, very quick to do so.
Yeah, it's just getting the more aggressively and getting the deep vision down. We saw Legacy do it when Carbon played Rek'Sai in their other game. Be very curious to see if Chobi wants to go for something similar.
And watching Cheese come back to the mid lane. Obviously going to be working towards probably the Athena's Unholy Grail, I'd have to guess. But no DFG to work to anymore.
So in the bottom, I think, in a bit of trouble. They're getting pretty low there in towards his side of the map. Zahi, though, we'll find out the grunt there down the bottom. Moobinbro getting aggressive there, poking in with the rockets. All someone is up there for immunity here. But not the case there for Ronu. Just had their flashes. Chobi, though, coming in. That's a good price seeker. Great binding. The heal popped in there as well. The tunnel comes in. Juni went for the flash play, but Overroad already flashed out.
Able to get out in the top lane. Jax is in trouble as well.
Yeah, bad game. Little may have to be a bit careful there. Looks like Zahi rotated him over there. Jax does get his way back towards his turret, though. Just doing it off screen on the minimap. So he'll be fine here. And good dodge of the gank there, but Chobi really getting aggressive. Oh, that was very... That doesn't actually work, unfortunately.
No, hit a minion, actually. Minion blocked right there. It's trying to stop the back. And at the same time, it looks like Evan going to try to take the dragon.
So good pressure there. Begamore even teleporting immediately back to his lane with his Phage just to keep the pressure on and keep immunity in the top side. So a good rotation here. T-Gun's down here, but he doesn't have his ulti. Can't really look to contest. Uberbro way too low as well. They're going to try for a sniper. Juni goes in, and Sivir does get the dragon.
It was a dangerous dragon there. It took a long time and a lot of damage to pick it up, but the teleport was not used by JK, so he hadn't backed in time to be able to teleport down and contest that objective. So at least Avant are paid off with the first dragon.
Yeah, and I have to credit Bagamore. He's had a very strong start to his lane here on Jax. We saw he got the clever trade early on. That was a very smart teleport back to make sure JK Smith, he couldn't join them at the dragon pit. And this Jax is not quite there, but he's getting going.
Yeah, I mean, it's the early camp at level one gives you such an experience advantage in the top lane. Even coming in late, the amount of minions you miss, maybe the first two minions in lane, because of course, the first instinct is try to hold the wave to allow creeps to die. Once you realize what's happened and you try and push fast, you just don't have the option to do that, especially as Aurelia, who's fiercely single target till she gets her ultimate. And that experience advantage is paying dividends in the top.
Yeah, nice little shield there in the mid from Kensti as well. This cheese will kind of roll in here. Clearing out creeps very efficiently. Bit of a CS lead there up against Kensti, but nothing massive so far. And Kensti, with the first blood there on the Lulu pick, has to be feeling very comfy.
Yeah, I mean, it just makes her safer. Like, obviously, it doesn't give her any more real 1v1 trading power. She'll do respectable damage in trades, but Lulu solo kills outside of the odd game definitely don't come in that often.
Yeah, and again, Chobi has kept up a very moderate amount of pressure. This is much more reminiscent of the style that I think we saw from towards the end of last year during the regional final. He's not over ganking, but he's setting up strong ganks, and when he isn't going back, he's setting up more tunnels in his jungle and making sure he keeps farming.
I can only assume that he looked back at the VODs of last week and saw that he was granting his team really big advantages in the early game, and then one over-aggressive move was really costing his team.
Good hook there down as well. Uberbro gets so low from the Boomerang Blade, and we talk about Jinx having fun here in this matchup. Does have the BF store, but you cannot get caught by those hooks.
No, I mean, once the death sentence comes in, Uberbro's now so far behind, has the minigun, so of course, because he autos a lot, even though it's only the 3% lifesteal coming out of the Doran Blade, will still get his health up fairly quickly. Just has to worry about a dive.
Yeah, health potion helping out there as well. Shelby, thankfully, not too close down towards the bottom, so Uberbro and T-Gun will continue cleaning things up. T-Gun actually looking to get aggressive. Pops the ulti on the Maz, but the lantern has come through. The T-Gun flash, it's very smart play, and now going to go back in. Mizui a little low, but Uberbro going to follow up in now as well. The ulti does go off, but it only hits Juni, and T-Gun has to be careful. He's getting very low here. The Thresh going back in, but Uberbro cutting back and forth very well. There's the reset to get excited. Maz can be in trouble now as well. Does go down. Shelby gets the kill, but very smart 2v2 immunity.
Yeah, there was excellent flashes on both sides right there. I love the max range flash to get the tether continued, but Zahi up top, very nice counter game. What can bad game do?
He's nothing, unfortunately, as JK Smithy does claim the kill. Good gank pressure there by Zahi, and the game opening up really hard now.
Yeah, both junglers positioned very well at polar opposite ends of the map. Chobi's going to be able to push in the lane right here, so a double kill. We'll lose some minions, but Uberbro, he'll be happy with the trade.
Yeah, T-Gun, we talk about him being an aggressive player. Morgana, not a hyper-aggressive support, but he definitely made some aggression work there.
I mean, the understanding to be able to flash over that wall. It was so easy to fat finger that, not get over that structure, but got it in. We're going to see the replay right here. The flash over the wall here is what really deserves it. To follow the lantern there, understand the range so well, opens up this potential kill here. The counter flash from Maz is excellent. Stops the Super Mega Dark Rock getting the kill right there. T-Gun's eventually going to fall right here just to the damage coming in from Chelby. But to get the trade kill, that's the big thing right there. To get the trade kill, confirm the second one, now has a massive advantage in bot.
Yeah, Uber Bro, maybe a bit of a late switch to minigun there, but he's in trouble now. Hook just goes over. Chelby flash knock up there. Now Mad's going to follow him with the damage. Heal is getting popped. Good teleport there to counter it off by JK Smithy, and he did very well. In fact, might even turn it around. Chelby has to be careful. Good defensive box there by Juni, but a good slow. Finds the chomp result. That was beautifully positioned by Uber Bro, and now Juni in a whole host of trouble. Ulti follows as well. Forces the flash out. T-Gun is back though. Does go wide with the binding, but still chasing now. The Cork does come in. Gonna hit onto Mazui. T-Gun gonna get aggressive. Try and pick him up. The double kill down with the ulti for T-Gun. Well played immunity, but the teleport coming in for Bagamore. Jumps on the T-Gun. Gets the kill. But Jax are gonna get caught in the trompers and the binding. Could be in trouble. T's down here as well. And 4-for-1 across the board.
Yeah, the rotational play for immunity was so good right there. A double kill for the support Morgana. Padding the stats. Today has been a wonderful day for T-Gun, silencing the critics. Now 2-2-3. The teleport from Jax, he was just trying to make something happen right there, but just kind of gave more experience to the immunity side of being overleveled, being in a solo lane. Immunity looking good.
Yeah, the Jinx minigun snowball, they're just melting that poor tower in towards the bottom. That's 2-0 now on structures for immunity with JK Smithy actually, with Zahi, I believe, earlier on, getting good pressure onto that tower, and Aurelia was eventually able to take it. Kenzie, though, might be able to answer here in towards mid, but Cheese is here to clean the waves up, and Avant looking like a bit behind now. 3,000 gold in the hole, actually.
Yeah, we're going to see the replay right here. The teleport was the big MVP, of course. It stopped the three-man tower dive. It would have been an easy kill on Uber Bro. We're waiting for this kill to continue right here. So it gets the first kill, JK Smithy, and then Uber Bro is just very smart and staying involved in the fight. Uses the Super Mega Depth Rocket right here. We're waiting for the last second for the ultimate. T-Gun's waiting for it to come back off cooldown, and the timing is just fortuitous right there with the double kill. Cheese was at the back. He could have picked up the kills himself, so he might be a bit frustrated with his support, but it's all for the good.
Good chum, Cheese there as well, but a little low on mana, Azari, so Cheese can't fight too aggressively. Kenzie wants to go very far in, but Zahi joined in there as well. T-Gun's found Juni, though, bound him up, I believe, and now Zahi's going to come in. This dragon's back up in 25 seconds. Immunity and Avant both wanted. Oh, Zahi flash kicks him back. Cheese, though, not really enough mana for the stun there. Good chompers, though, back and low will flash out. Zahi going to chase him, that's a little too aggressive. Ulti just wide there. Good jukes from the Jack. That might force Avant off the dragon, but that was very, very slick moves there.
Yeah, it was good sidestep from the Jax, but as you mentioned, the charm, just not enough mana. Could only activate the Foxfire, so couldn't pick up the kill right there. But I mean, they'll take a second dragon. That gives them position on the third. Looking good here, immunity, although they are split away from the mid objective. They might have to give up that turret.
Yeah, Cheese kind of went back as well. Sport a Morella Nomicon, but Avant, good rotation going in. But JK Smithy wants to go in. That's a great spell shield there from us. But Kenzie now going to get chased down here by JK Smithy. Still going in. The death sentence lands. Good bind there to get them to disengage. The Sivirol pop there as well. And Avant get away with it.
Yeah, even though that turret is on literally one auto attack, it stays alive right here. Immunity still have position on the dragon. Avant, they're probably going to be able to force down mid, but Cheese, he's got his full mana. He's able to clear quite well.
Yeah, Infinity Edge done for Uber Bro as well, so this dragon's going to melt with the standing miniguns. DPSI tanking that nicely away from the rest of the team. And there's a quick dragon that the first one, I believe, goes to Immunity.
And again, the Jack's still significantly behind in terms of power spikes right here. We'll have a decent amount of gold. He's still sitting on 500 gold, so he's close to finishing off his Trinity Force right here, but he's being outmatched and outrotated by JK Smithy. Had to use that teleport just to pick up a kill trade, but JK Smithy's really made his impact felt around the map with that teleport down, stop the turret dive.
Yeah, really strong play there coming through, and again, you talked about Immunity's rotational play looking very solid here in this game so far, and nice to see them play together as a team. Immunity gonna pressure in towards the mid as well. Newly gotten Dragon Buff gonna help them out, and no charm there coming. Cheese, nice the Black Shield there as well to kind of help him poke under that turret. Couldn't all in, unfortunately, but a good bit of pressure.
I mean, the rotation of play has been a standby of three of their games. The first game, they kind of picked themselves into such a corner they could never really make their comp work. But the subsequent three games, especially against Rich Gang, a team well known for their early rotations, to pick up a significant dragon lead, eventually snowballing to a fifth dragon in that match, was a surprise for me. But they've continued it and snowballed it this week, and show that this should be a cornerstone of their game moving forward.
Yeah, Dragons, even though, there's a bit of a correction for me there earlier on, but it is one apiece there. Immunity picking up the last one, which was there first. Avant had the earlier one there as well, but Cheese looking to get aggressive here. Not really afraid of Kenzie. Good juke, though, using the Whimsy and the shield there to help him out. But at this point, Lulu doesn't really add anything other than a bit of utility and some decent AoE damage.
I mean, you have to mention, though, that Jax has hit that Trinity Force power spike. He's close to level 11. The ultimate from Lulu may be very relevant in a team fight, but they have to get grouping soon. The teleport advantage is with J.K. Smithy, although he's grouping at this point. He can split soon, and Jax is just waiting another 40 seconds or so for his to come up.
Yeah, the Siege coming through, and they're going to try and five-man mid here, and that Jinx going to help out. And unfortunately for Maz, he's pretty far behind on items at this point.
Yeah, I mean, Maz is really, really struggling right here. Hasn't got the Infinity Edge. Actually has the gold to be able to buy. He's quite even in CS right here. But it's a very big power spike to be behind in this Siege.
Yeah, Jinx so good with the one item. J.K. Smithy gets locked up there, but the Binding does hit onto Chelby. They're going to go in there. Transcendent Blade's popping in. Cheese wants it. The ult gets it there for Jinx. The tower goes down as well. She's still going very aggressive, but they get the kill. Jax might get the trade, but Immunity will take it.
I mean, that's all Jax could do. Doesn't have teleport up and hadn't grouped right here. Ah, the counter teleport comes in. Probably not even going to pick up this structure, but he might brute force it.
I mean, Jax going to take a lot of damage. He gets stunned for a long time under that turret. That's a cute blade surge, but J.K. Smithy going to get chunked out now by this Jax. Bad game lore. Turning it up. That Trinity Force made a world of difference. But Cheese gets the double there. Bind onto Maz as well. No follow-up there, but this Ahri's going off.
Yeah, Ahri's going off. She's getting big. 2-1 and 2 already. 23 CS up, even against this Lulu, who can comfortably wave clear. All the advantages in Ahri's camp.
And if Immunity keep pressuring like this with the comp they have, things are going to look very good. I mean, Uber Brawl at this point only really needs to be there to add damage and take out turrets. The Jinx get excited snowball is very real.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when you're able to have so much latent damage across the other members, there's three members here doing very relevant teamfight damage. Even Zahi at this point, and T-Gun has to be spoken about because he's managed to snowball so well. If you can get that first reset without really over-investing yourself, keeping your flash, keeping your heal, I mean, Jinx's potential in a teamfight is massive.
Yeah, and I mentioned her one-item power spike already. It's a combination of Rockets doing added AD damage for the crit, and crits just helping you get resets a little more often by helping you on the damage front. Ubura is very scary right now, and it only gets worse.
Yeah, once the critical strike comes in, of course, we have to remember that on 5.2, the Infinity Edge has been nerfed a little bit. Doesn't have quite the same critical strike. We might see the Phantom Dancer come in, because they have very good wave clear coming out from Ahri right here. Once the Phantom Dancer comes in, that's the Jinx that you're really scared of.
Yeah, and you can see Cheese level 11. Got a need to see Large Rod, the Sork Shoes, and his Morella Nomicon here. No DFG, unfortunately, for this particular Ahri, but still a very potent threat here in this particular game. And he's already been doing work getting aggressive. We saw it on his Swain in the last game they played. Ahri has a lot of potential here for Immunity, and they're playing very well. Maybe the Vision is where they want to be looking next.
Yeah, I mean, we look at the map right here. They haven't managed to advance any aggressive Vision into the enemy jungle. They have exclusive Vision of the Dragon buff, so they are in the best position to pick that up in 2 minutes. But they're only now starting to get their first aggressive wards into the Avant-Garde jungle.
Yep, Zahi helping there with the Sightstone, of course, and some decent items coming through across the board there for Immunity. Avant, though, we saw what the Jax can do with that Trinity Force. Very scary looking there. Kensi's a little behind on items right now. T-Gun actually going to move and look for the steal. Does bind it up. The smite comes through. And good denial there. The Blue of Juni actually could be in trouble here. The ulti coming through. That's a great wild growth though from Kensi.
Yeah, the wild growth keeps Juni alive, but they will lose their blue buff here. I mean, the wards are only just starting to get pushed in. They're denying the pink wards, which have been the cornerstone of advanced play today. They may have been losing so far, but they have been very good at keeping vision up in their own jungle.
And you can see on the top line, their bad game lore continuing to keep pushing on this Jax. He's getting ahead on CS, and I have a funny feeling that J.K. Smithy doesn't feel very comfortable trying to fight this Jax at the moment.
Even though he has the kill advantage that lane, Jax does reach a point where he's just unmanageable, especially now with the Mercury Tread start. Oh, Chelby's in trouble.
Yeah, good attempt at the flash kick. The Lantern will keep him safe, but Cheese gonna dive back in. A beautiful charm land. The Black Shield helps us. Cheese goes way too aggressive. The Juni with a great play, and Mizui claims that kill.
Perhaps Cheese's first misplay of the day is just a really aggressive flash. He was only ever gonna get a one-for-one trade. Very unnecessary to go in a game when they're already 3,000 gold ahead. But they'll be very happy with the result. Avant, they've been in positions where their smart use of vision has given them a chance to get back into a game, only for it to eventually be snowballed away from them. If they can keep this vision up and get a few more picks, they'll be certainly in with a chance.
Not Tegan there. Good Black Shield. Juni, though, will ride us way in. Lantern comes in with actually the stun going to land in, but Tegan actually gets caught up by the box as well. Zahi, Uberbro going to come through as well on the Jinx. Boss Quinn's claim will actually keep them back. T-Gun very aggressively buying the item for a bit more damage. But if aren't, they might actually have gone control of the Dragon Pit now.
Yeah, for them to get the Dragon advantage with how this game has gone would be very big, but Immunity are certainly not going to give it up without a fight.
Yeah, Cheese on the way as well. Rabadon's not quite done, but he's got the components, so doing a good amount of flat damage here, especially because Kensi still has gold to spend, I believe, and he's hanging out of the Dragon. The Binding does go slightly wide. Zai gets chunked out massively there. The Pink Lord there and the pick and help of Aunt, but they look a little scared right now.
Yeah, Jax is freshly shopped. He has the added health right here from the Giant's Belt. does eat a lot of trade damage here, and it's a very tense standoff between the two teams.
Ubero getting poked out by a boomerang blade there as well. Has to be very cautious around the pitch. Shelby just going to go wide of a chum, but Cheese with some great poke on the Ari as well. So Immunity going to start this dragon off for themselves. Ubero not much lifesteal apart from the Dorans, but a great chompers there in the choke might keep them, and it does get them the second dragon. Very well played.
Yeah, actually getting full value out of the chompers right there. Completely denying anyone on that path. Very smart use of that ability. They couldn't engage over it, and Avant, they have to give up that dragon.
Yeah, and Jax, this is kind of the problem. He does need some time to get going. His first damage item is a big spike, usually in lane, especially in this case, where he's able to match the Trinity Force of Aurelia, but he really does want to be going tankier. That's what you need on bruises. You need the damage, and you need the defensive item.
And he hasn't felt confident enough to go the Frozen High. It feels like he needs the flat health pickup right here, so kind of pricing himself into a Randall and still going to be very powerful. Still should be able to out-duel JK Smithy, especially with the Merc Treads to cancel the Equilibrium Strike CC duration. But this Jax, he just needs time. And look, he's got Lulu and Sivir on his side. They should be able to buy time, but Maz is really taking a lot of damage.
That was an awesome slow there by Tegan. I thought he was baiting the Spell Shield, but Sivir wasn't having any of it. So instead, they just forced the flash out and the ulti there. So Mizui, who wasn't having a particularly fun game against this Jinx, despite the CS, good bind as well. Juni could be in trouble here. Ubero might follow in, but the rest of AV kind of coming through. That's a great chomp as well. Ubero with the Black Shield just goes in with impunity. The ulti a bit wide. Juni did flash.
And Jax's issue here is he doesn't have any defensive wards. And you can see Immunity, they're all coming to this red side jungle to make sure it's not safe at all for Bad Game Law to try and farm against Aurelia in this top lane.
Yeah, they've done a very good job actually of making space here. We saw the last kill, the last fight that Immunity lost before the last dragon was actually getting aggressive onto Shelby because they're, again, trying to force in towards that top side.
Exactly. Anything that can force Jax away from the minion wave right here, force him from being able to farm fairly safely and have a decent 1v1 matchup against Aurelia is massive for IM because only the pocket Jax in the late game that gives Avant a real chance of coming back into this game.
Yeah, Shelby here trying to get some more vision control down as well. Randuin must be close to being finished there as well. Chasing the item, he's going to try and finish up first off and going for a bit more of the tanky right here. Not able to get the snowball Trinity Force that Carbon got in their game.
No, it's a very, very different game than the previous Rek'Sai we've seen where, I mean, ganking pressure wasn't even necessary for the Rek'Sai. It was just kind of an auxiliary damage threat. Here has had to have a lot of appearances in lane, but it's kind of really delayed the power spike in terms of farming. It is 12 CS above the Lee Sin, but definitely not had the impact that Zahi has.
Yeah, and speaking of impact, Cheese has picked up a big item for not the next Dragonfire, but whatever move they want to make next. He has the blue and a Rabadon's Death Cat completed now as well. I like the distortion boots on Tegan there as well. In fact, Kensty very low there around the blue buff. Shelby could be in trouble here. Zahi going to look for him, finds him with a great Q, looks to ward hop and kick him back, but Shelby actually just tunnels away.
Yeah, able to tunnel away. They didn't have to use the flash right there to stop the kick engage. Really nice play right here. Jax has got a very successful split push going on right here. And if there's no dragon to pick up, we have to remember that with Sivir and Lulu, the wave clear is massive on advanced side. So if they can continue to delay this game, this Jax, he's got 211 CS, the most in the game right now. He's getting big.
Yeah, important pickup there for the Lulu, like you mentioned. Has the need to see Large Rod done? Not quite the death cap, but the flat AP going to help immensely with the wave clear and, of course, keeping these hyper carries alive. And it's funny as well, it's not really the Sivir that you want to keep alive so much as the big Jax.
Absolutely, it is the Jax. Going for more damage favor right here. He's abandoned the Randuin's Omen in favor of the Bilgewater. Again, perhaps trusting the Lulu for the tank steps.
Oh, Shelby again going to be found by Zahi. Charm a little wide there. Shelby forced a flash on Cheese. Goes in aggressive again. Chase is in there with his ulti. But Bag and Ball's on top of him. A cool black shield up at Zahi. Going to get blown up there. Flash hops and it's not enough. Now Juni going to play back T-Gun. Kensi just eats that Ahri and 3-0 Avant.
I mean, so much utility for this Jax between the On the Hunt and the ultimate coming out from Lulu right here. They face checked the Jax and they paid for it. And now it's a real Baron threat right here. But a lot of damage still alive on Immunity's side.
Yeah, JK Smithy ulti up. Ubero ready with all the summoners plus his ulti as well. Baron is getting shredded here by Avant. But Immunity might be able to take it in. JK Smithy gets Polymorph. He's going to dive in onto Kensi. Wants to go in with the damage to Immunity. Gets the first kill. Ubero going in there. Can they 2v5? Gets the next one. So that's 2-0. But Bad Game Law chasing in there. Finds the top of the Jinx. Heal gets popped there as well. Ubero, can he 1v3? The Boomerang play comes in. Gets excited to dodge the last few balls. Goes back in onto Mizui. Gets the triple kill and stops the Baron.
Shelby's going to have to run away. But beautiful use of Jinx's range and passive to kite right there. We talk about the no escape Jinx. But she looked just fine
there.
6-1-4 now on that Jinx as well. Uber Bro went off there on that Baron fight. Keeps Avant off it as well. And Shelby's like, I don't really want to do this.
Well, you have to ask the question, where was the clear call to disengage off the Baron? They continued to DPS it up as Irelia walked into melee range of Kensti and just basically assassinated her. They needed a clear call to disengage right there, and they did not get it.
No, and Avant now, that Baron attempt cost them a lot more than they would have liked, and let's see that again.
So this is after Lulu's already died right here, and the man, of course, to watch is Uber Bro. There's three healthy members coming up here. Bad Game Law has already used the Counter-Strike, so is able to be kited out right here. Maz walks into an area where he doesn't have vision, even with the Scrying Ult right there. And Uber Bro with the fancy moves picks up the triple kill and denies the dragon.
Yes, and bury the Baron even there. The bigger minion there. And I mean, with the dragon, that still would have been great. The fact that it was the Baron as well. Going in 2v5 there to defend, leading into an eventual 1v3 and the triple kill. Amazing play there by Immunity.
And shrugging off any of the armor right here. Just going to go for the Bloodthirst to pick up as there's not many high armor values on the Avant side. They're stacking the flat health, so why not pick up the Bloodthirster for a bit more insurance?
Yeah, nice little defensive item against the Jax as well as Jake Smithy going to dive in onto Journey. Transcendent Blade getting popped and Uber Bro gets another kill there. He's really scary.
Yeah, that first order did a third of the health, if not for the inner turret shield coming there onto Sivir. Sivir versus Jinx in the late game. She might be able to navigate in the early game, but just falls away late.
Yeah, and this is the big power points for Jinx coming through now as well. Does have the static shiv and moving very swiftly into the BT. Thanks in part to all of the gold he just got from the 1v3 triple. Dragon now going to get shredded down by Immunity as well. And that's three, and that's a very important dragon for Jinx.
Yeah, and now Jax again, giving the enemy so much more move speed, makes him just that much more kiteable. It's a big issue for the champ to close the distance right here. He got so fortunate when he was face-checked by the over-aggression from Cheese, and the Frozen Heart is competed by JK Smithy. How much work is it doing here, Page Time? Four auto-attack champions on the advanced side, because of course Lulu's passive, all about getting those extra autos in.
Yeah, it really is. And Immunity going to look for a big siege now as well. JK Smithy, so scary. If he stays alive in this... Sorry, I meant... JK Smithy looking good. I definitely meant Uber Bro here. He's had quite the game on Jinx so far. Gonna go back and shop. Probably has enough gold for the BT. Not quite, but gonna get a very key Vamp Scepter.
They're gonna pick up the Vamp Scepter again. Another very useful tool against Jax. Jax is gonna be singling out the No Escape Uber Bro every fight. About 2 minutes till Uber Bro's flash is up. So there definitely is a window for him to be assassinated right here. But no real pressure for Immunity to try and close out the game in the next 2 minutes. Just buy time for Jinx to have that kind of insurance spell. And we can see already, Jax down the bottom, the sweat push is on.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned the insurance there for late game there in Uber Bro. Avant kind of trying to get their own late game insurance policy kicked into gear with the Jax as well, but Tegan's so aggressive. Grave Flash, Frost Queen's there, the Lantern comes up, Mizui gets saved, but Immunity Burst and Flashes, they'll be happy.
Yeah, interesting. They didn't trust the Lantern ride right there, just went for the Flash there. Look, it might have stopped an engage, but it does mean the Flash is on cooldown.
Yep, so Cheesy going to move in, clearing out waves very swiftly with the Blue Buff Arry. Hasn't quite actually got any more items yet. He must have a pretty big fistful of gold. Almost enough for an Idris Ladrod. Sitting about 1590 there. So Cheese probably does want to go back and spend for a bit more of a power point here. But Immunity needs to take the momentum they have here in this game. As long as they're keeping Bad Game Law busy and getting aggressive, that's all they really need to do.
Yeah, they're continuing to deny resources away here. They're going to take away the blue buff. You look at Jax right here. He's done for damage. He's basically capped for damage short of picking up level 16. They have to fight smartly because there could still be a super-powered Jax.
Good hook on to Cheese there as well. He gets out on the RET. Got great ulti there in the middle of the team. And JK Smithy just goes in there. But Mads gets the first kill. JK Smithy, not quite enough. A good hook there as well. But Zaya's coming back in. Uber Bro, he's coming around the side now as well. The Charm lands in onto Chelby. But Kenzie gets the next kill. And this would be 2v4 again. Uber Bro has no health left, so gotta dodge the Praise Taker here from Chelby. Chelby, they're gonna get sped up. Sniped him for the shutdown. And Avant, they're fighting back now.
Yeah, it looked like they were kiting away effectively on Jackson. To be fair, Bad Game Mode did fall early right there, but the rest of the team was scattered, and Maz was able to free auto at the back. They pick up the Infinity Edge PD on that Maz, and he still does relevant damage, but now they're going to try the Baron again, and it did not work out for them the first time.
Well, thankfully for them, Uber Bro is not alive right now. And Ari's fairly low on health, and Tegan, the only other member of Immunity alive, is very far away. The teleport actually coming for Bad Game Law to make sure they secure the Baron, and this time, Avant are going to get it.
The insurance comes in here with the teleport. I think it's useful just because now if they group, they have so much wave clear between Lulu and Sivir, and still the potential for a dive from this Jax. So as a grouped five, it's going to be difficult for Munich to clear waves against the Baron Buff and all the wave clear on Avant's side.
Yeah, she's just missing that Q there as well to potentially deny the back and at least get an exit kill. And this game is about 2,000 gold in the hole for Avant. They've actually jumped ahead to 1,500 gold in the lead. We talk about Baron being a big impact neutral objective in Avant. They tried it once, didn't work out. The second time, though, very much working out.
And I feel like they're about a Randuin's away from this Jax really being able to influence fights. It's level 15, so close to 16. Of course, 18 has become a very important level for Jax now that Counter-Strike gets down to such a low cooldown. I believe it's about 12 seconds at max rank right there. Of course, can be reduced by CDR. The ability to use that ability 2-3 times in a fight can be really, really big for the late game Jax. He doesn't have the base stats of old. His laning is a lot more difficult, but 252 CS and double damage items down. The champ is here.
And Jinx is doing great damage here on immunity as far as their late game goes, but I feel like they just can't really get this Jax off their team.
And the Jax does, even though he's split pushing here, you see there is defensive wards down for him in the jungle of IM. I don't know when they had the time to get aggressive warding down, just given the pattern of the last few minutes. But they are playing smartly over this really powerful top laner.
Yeah, I guess the one thing for immunity that they can hold on to here is they do have a dragon advantage. It's 3-1 currently in dragons, with immunity having the 3. And dragons back up in a minute 30. So that fourth dragon coming through, I mean, maybe that's the way to melt through the Jax. Try and get that fifth dragon.
Yeah, the fifth dragon obviously would be massive, but a long way away at this stage. You know, at least another 13 minutes away from being able to claim that one. So it's going to be time. It's going to be a lot of time. They're going to have to, obviously, the reset button's been hit with the Baron buff being taken. They're trying to get an advantage, but I'm not sure JK Smithy can stand up to this Jax right here. So again, if they can defend him well, he's definitely the person the whole comp is built around.
Yeah, but this dragon coming up in a minute, great timing on the Bloodthirster there for Uberbro. Needed it desperately against the Jax in the last little fight near the Dragon Pit, and going to need it here as well. I mean, the armor not quite out, like you mentioned, Papa, so going to be pretty good so far. And if he keeps up the gold here at this level, a bad game, lol. Once again, that's a good stun by JK Smithy.
He's about 400 gold away from a straight Randuin's Omen right here. That's definitely an item he has to pick up before they fight, because as you mentioned right there, Jinx is going to be doing a lot of damage to him. Once he gets to Randuin's, he'll be able to shred away Jinx, and even if she picks up a QSS, it's basically going to require a whole team to peel this Jax off of Jinx.
Yeah, and this Jax doing enough damage. The Baron Dump minions helping us on. He's just going to tank the JK Smithy damage, eat through the turret here on the champ, and Jax is getting bigger here. Bad game, lol. We can have a very good game here in this one.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's so impressive for a sub player to really be tailored a comp around, but they show a lot of trust in Bad Game Lol. He might not be here in a few weeks when Porky comes back into the team, but he's making an impact today.
Yeah, Nirvana again would love a win, even more so here with the sub. Zahi does look in there. Cheese trying to flank there towards the bottom, but Avant doing a good job splitting up their Baron buffs, getting pressure down. The Baron buff has dropped now, but the dragon's back, and if Avant want to fight here, they can go in. This will be a brawl here. Johnny though does miss the stun. Zahi kicks him back in there, and that's a very good pick.
Yeah, it's so important to pick up the first kill, because so much setup CC on this team comes from the Thresh. There is no other true engage on the side of Avant right here. So they'll probably have to give up the fourth dragon. And again, that does put up a timer on the game.
Important ulti still up for immunity as well. So pretty uncontestable looking dragon hit. She's actually going in, finds the snare onto Chelby with the trump, goes over the wall there, and Uberbro gets another kill, plus the fourth dragon for immunity.
So unnecessary for Chelby to be sitting there. I don't know what he was realistically hoping to get. Maybe an exit kill from someone over-aggressively going to farm the bottom lane waves. Just so unnecessary from Chelby. Jax has to back right here. They lack the wave clear now, even with Sivir and Lulu available against the five members. And immunity could get a whole lot out of this dragon.
I mean, you thought Jinx was bad enough as far as pushing turrets. Now with both the minion pushing and the turret pushing buff as well from the dragon. Forget about the fifth dragon right now. Jinx is already shredding through structures.
So immunity really needs to redouble on wards right here. They've been excellent at picking up these blue buffs on spawn, but they haven't got the wards down to really justify the position they're in this game. That's why we've been able to see Jax split push so effectively. The side waves are pushing very much in the advantage of Avant right here, so we're actually going to see the turret falling in the top lane right here. If they can reset the global minion wave pushes, then they're definitely going to be in a position to be able to try and take this inhibitor. But right now, the minion waves are really pushing against immunity.
Yeah, and backend Law's done great with the split push. Avant controlling the side of, like you mentioned, very well. Hence, he does steal away the blue buff as well, so he'll be happy to at least get one, and that one at this point, given that immunity have done a very good job of stealing him. And this game, weirdly enough, is almost broken off into top versus bottom in terms of map halves that these teams are fighting over.
It's just surprisingly so even. 1,000 gold advantage for Avant, 5 structures to 4, still quite a big kill lead for Immunity, but it's the structures right here and the rotations and the CS we have to mention, of course, the 57 CS advantage for Jax right here. And JK Smithy just can't stand up to him in a split push, so it limits the options Immunity have for how they send their members out on the rift.
And JK Smithy sort of has to split the difference on his resistances as well. Lulu doing actually a pretty decent amount of magic damage. I love the Lich Bane coming up for Kenshi for an additional AP ratio. And a lack of Locket to me, it's not the best here with strong AD champions, but I would still like to see one from Jarvan. I mean, Lee Sin.
I mean, it makes sense to pick one up. It's relevant damage, but it's almost a case of nobody really wants to be itemizing magic resist because it's a Lulu mid. So picking up an Aegis makes sense, and Lee Sin doesn't have a rigid build path. He can basically pick up any utility item and fit it into his build right here. I mean, Uber Bro is going full damage, and the big risk here is that if that Black Shield is ever popped, this Jax is going to definitely be able to tear through him.
Yeah, Lich Bane for Lulu going to make that job a lot easier here. Kensty kind of just has one job here. Stick to whatever target he can and try and provide shields for this Jax. Bad game, lol. Getting set up to be very big in the next team fight that Avant has.
Yeah, so close to level 18 right here. That's when that's definitely the biggest point in power, because he can max out that Counter-Strike finally. Going to split push again, and JK Smithy, he couldn't handle him before. It's not going to change now.
I mean, Spirit Visage not too bad, but probably still can't handle this Jax like you mentioned. Maybe I'm going to look for a Randy one on top of the Frozen Heart with the Grass out there as well. Shelby, sorry, going in aggressive with the Rek'Sai ulti.
And the Rek'Sai ultimate, always a little bit too much bark and not enough fight, but the fight's on him mid.
Zai going in, taking a little too much damage on Mazda. Spell shields, the charm, and Uber Bro gonna get jumped in here by Juni. Great play back. Kenshi going in, a great double knockup there. Shelby's in the back, and Uber Bro does fall. Now Maz going on top of T-Gun. She's forced to get out there, but he's getting jumped up by Bad Gamelor. There's the Thresh going down. Three quick kills for Avant.
Yeah, almost completely wiped there before the Jax and Aurelia even get into the fight. I thought without Bad Gamelor grouped, so much of the gold in his pocket, Avant wouldn't be able to pick up a pick, but they instantly assassinate Uber Bro through all the flashes they had available. It was the knockup from Chelby that was heroic right there. And what a great timing. Baron's just respawned.
That was an excellent fight there for Avant, using the Lulu Rek'Sai so well in combination. And just Zai went a little too aggressive there on his Lee Sin. That's going to give up the kills and the Baron, it looks like, here as well. There's no contest coming through from Immunity. And Avant going to continue to grow a gold lead now.
Yeah, Avant are doing their best to avoid the 0-4 start. We'll see the replay right here. Zai goes in aggressive. This is an initiation from Immunity. But the hook by Johnny is just incredible on Uro. He flashes through the box right there. Still going to be 99% slowed. Nothing he can do. Bad game lol coming in at the end is just icing on the cake. But, I mean, Uber Bro, you can't eat those hooks, mate.
And the interesting thing here is that we have a very tense game now. Avant have a gold lead and the Baron lead, but this next dragon is Immunity's fifth. So this game could turn very quickly. Last Whisper Darnell for Uber Bro as well. Things have gotten tense here, despite the gold lead that Avant have built for themselves.
So we see Jax split pushing down the bottom. What he actually needs to do here is to group with this Thresh and give them some pressure on clearing wards around the dragon. As you say, 1:30 to that structure's up. Johnny's probably going to be assassinated in the transition here.
Yeah, Zahi uses that smite here as well, but we'll have another charge ready to go fairly quickly. Uber Bro gets a kill on the Johnny. That's a great pick there, and that fifth dragon looking a whole lot easier for IM.
It's so important to group with your support this late when your main objective is to keep the enemy away from dragon. Even with the Baron buff, even with the minion waves being pushed in right here, the amount of statistics you get from that fifth dragon is not something you can give away for free. And if you're split pushing, again, you face check an Ahri, you're dead.
I mean, the Baroned up minions doing a pretty heroic job here for Avant, but Uber Bro will try and clear them out with the rockets. Zai going to find Bad Game Lol as well. 45 seconds out of that Dragon Scuttle Crab. Going to give them much needed vision there around that objective. Immunity, they know what they want. It's the fifth dragon here, but Avant, no, they have to deny it.
Johnny's going to have enough time to group with the team, so this should be a team fight as long as no one is caught.
Yeah, Shelby, does he say a flash kick there onto him as well? The knockup that comes through on the cheese, but Uber Bro just firing him with the rockets. Shelby is very tanky, but it's not enough here.
You could see Lulu was warned off by Chelby. They give away the kill. They know that's going to be at minimum the dragon right here. They just didn't want the game to end off one pick.
Well, when it's the fifth dragon, that's a bad minimum here, Papa Smith. The Immunity going to rocket into the pit now. 10 seconds left till the respawn. Avant might try something heroic.
They can. They still have the ultimate from Kenshi right here. We could still see Jax try and win this fight, but if they get it wrong, this game will end.
Yeah, it will here, and Maz has to be careful. He's got great damage here in the Sivir plus the QSS with his four diamond items, but Immunity going in, the dragon getting low back. Aimel going to dive in here as well into the Jax. Can they get it? Zai wants it so bad. He goes in. He gets the fifth dragon, and now Uber Bro will get a turn on the damage. JK Smithy dives in onto back and loves. They kill the Jax. That's great. Now Kenshi trying to go and gets Charmeloo and blown up to pieces. Uber Bro, though, can't survive this. this time. Mazda now running in, and Cheese, the only one left. A quadra kill, actually, for Maz now as well. Can he make it to Penta? Gets killed though by Cheese. Hook though lands in. Maz looks for it, but it's not enough. Thresh gets the last kill and is the only one left.
Massive burst coming out from Journey to pick up that kill. An absolutely insane fight. They used everything on Jax and just ignored with the Infinity Edge, Bloodthirst, the Last Whisper, and just a massive Sivir in the backline. We spent all this time talking about Jax, but the Sivir was by far the MVP of that fight.
Yeah, insane amounts of damage they dished out by Mazui, who's crept up to a pretty quiet 300 CS or so in a 12-4-7 on this Sivir.
So we're going to see the replay right here. Of course, bad game laws where your eyes will gravitate, but he takes so much damage at the start that once this dragon comes through, you think, all right, the fight's over. But watch Maz in the backline right here. No one's even interested in auto-attacking him. And the burst of damage onto Uber Bro, there are three autos, completely takes him down. He gets the quadra and, of course, gets very, very greedy to try and pick up the Penta right here. One burst of one spell rotation takes him down, but watch this last. Okay, the boomerang, but it doesn't fade on death. And Thresh picks up the kill.
Yeah, Thresh gets the last laugh. 9 kills in that team fight. Thresh, the only one left alive, and Journey gets a lot of credit there. Those hooks in that fight landed so well, and that pretty much gave Matt all the space he needed to just dish out the damage on Sivir. And when you're a short run JD like Sivir, that is a big round of applause to the support player.
Very interesting last item pick here by Maz. The defensive option is the Guardian Angel. We've seen this fall away a lot, but it makes a bit of sense because he's got a Lulu in his pocket, which potentially gives him an extra 800, 1,000 health, which synergizes very well with the resists available. Also, if they're really focusing on assassinating one target down, they've got Jax and Sivir right here. So whichever one they choose, they're really going to pay for. And Maz has now got the Guardian Angel, the second life in his pocket.
Well, it better be the choice he wants because he sold his QSS to finish it. But full damage Sivir now done as well. QSS also picked up for Uber Bro. So going to get a bit of extra 80 out of the Mercurial Scimitar. Nice there on the Jinx. But of course, wants to get out of the stuns here. Jax, especially with that Counter-Strike, very scary. But this Jax is an unbelievable threat. Banshee's failed done now as well. And it's, you know, a low threat comp here for AV, but two very scary ones.
I mean, Jax is the late game threat of all of them. He's just so strong in the late game if he can close distance. That's a big if. Chelby in the mid has to be careful. Just does able to age to avoid that skill shot. They need to be so careful. There's 8 flashes available right here. Only Juni, JK Smithy, I believe. Oh no, Zahi also has it on cooldown right here. So slight flash advantage on advanced side. But both AD carries have it available.
Good poke here into Chelby. Charm Lance as well. Lance not enough, but the damage coming in. Chelby going to get aggressive, but that will flash him out. Now BGL wants to get in aggressive, but the ult's been popped there by Maz. They're running very swiftly around the map, but bit of a reset there as I am bait out some ultis.
Chelby's gone full tank right here. Randuin's War Mugs, Thorn Mail, all available. He will have the health regenerating quite well, but even getting chunked out by the Q's coming out from Cheese, right? The Little Lance actually doing very respectable damage against the low magic resist on the side of Ahri. Everyone needs to be careful here because the burst damage coming out of every carry in this game is insane.
Yeah, and Chelby, I think, maybe realizing that he's aggressive positioning, cost him his life a few too many times, going full tank like you mentioned. And with the burrowing there, he regens so quickly with the Warmog sticking.
So much initiation pressure has actually been put on here. So many of them has been the burrow strike into the flash to try and get the knock up from Chelby. He understands his role is to get in the middle of a fight and just live as long as possible. Has good base damages, Kensty and Cheese.
Oh my god, that's so close. Cheese still alive though. Picks runs off there and Chelby tries to get aggressive but can't finish it off. Tegon there, good defensive binding as well. Baggermore still in the bottom pushing. Immunity kind of on the back foot now.
Yeah, they're trying to get the minion wave pushing in the back. It will be pushing in the top. So they do have, again, the minion waves pushing in their advantage. It's just such a tense game. I mean, both these AP carries, whenever they trade, do their whole enemy's health in one rotation. So much damage from both of them and so little magic resist right here.
Tense might be an understatement in this game. This is insane right now. And Avant still behind the dragons would have been up 2 barons, I believe, in this game. The next baron's up in 15 seconds. The next dragon in a minute 30. And Zahi has to be careful. Kensi does not mess around with the damage.
Worth knowing that, of course, at this point, the dragon buff has worn out. They revert to 4 dragons right here. So no 12% stats coming out on immunity. The next fight will be very, very close. And in the bottom lane, you can see in the minimap, very aggressive push coming out of Jax.
Oh, that's a good kick. Actually knocks up Maz there, but Kensty, it's not quite enough without follow-up. The Uber Bro can't close the distance, and Zahi wastes the cooldowns trying to get the initiation.
It's such a bloodbath right here. There's no wards down really from any team, and the fight's on.
Cheese is in so much trouble. Johnny, though, does come onto Uber Bro, but he's not there yet. Plays him back, though, wants to go in, and Chelby is just massive down with the Wild Growth. Uber Bro gets blown up by BGL and Thresh, and now Smithy gonna get hooked up there as well. That's 3 kills for AV. Make it 4 there as Jax gets the double, and this might be game.
On the fourth attempt, they finally make it good, and who else but the sub bad game Lolon Jax completely warped this game with his amazing farming. 370 CX never could be matched by the Aurelia. We talked about the late game. We never thought it would come, but it came with aplomb.
Yeah, I mean, best supporting AD might have to go to Mazui here in this game, who's just beasted through immunity on this Sivir. Tigon, he wants to defend, but there's just nothing he can really do. Jax could face tank the turrets with Morgana hitting him, and I don't think he cares too much. The towers are going to melt. The Nexus will join shortly after an immunity. They wanted it sober, but Avad will not into the 0-4 losing streak. They finally pick up a win, and it's in style against immunity.
Just a massive win right there, and a triumph over minion waves. That was the big thing coming out of Vant. They were very smart. The minion waves were always pushed, and even though it felt like immunity were well on top in the middle, in the mid game, they were never able to translate that into an inhibitor, into a Baron. Both Barons, I think, maybe even a third Baron, going to a Vant right there. And it's the warding and the vision. It's the warding and the mini waves that really let down immunity. So we'll see a replay right here. There were so many Titanic fights, but we'll start off with one of the very, very late game fights. I'm sure we're going to see a massive chunk coming in as I see the glitter lads coming through. So we'll roll the tape right here. And the first initiation, it's all on Chelby once again with the flash. They have a very limited initiation choices, but Chelby fights so smartly to get the first pick. And after that, there's just so many tanks on the side that whatever Avant do, they can just run at the enemy and there's nothing they can do. There's so high health bars. Everyone there has about 3,000-4,000 effective health in the front line. But Chelby, credit to him, on a champion that finds it very hard to gap close, so many times the Burrow Strike into the Flash initiation paid dividends, and he understood his role this game. He built tanky, he was all about that first knockup, and it worked out.
And that's twice now that we've seen a pretty creative, you know, two damage threat drop from a team. It was immunity in the last game, but Avant came up big there with that one. Lulu looking nice there for Kensi. And with that, we're done for this day. But let's take a look at the results here of the day as well. Kind of recap what's happened here. Up in the first match, it'll be Legacy versus Sudden here. The win there for Legacy, and of course, they rampage through Avant for in style for the 2-0.
But then Immunity, they continue their good form they showed last week with the win over Sudden Fear. They wanted to cap off the week with that third victory to take them equal with Legacy, but they fell to Avant, who on the fourth attempt finally pick up their first win.
And that was a crazy last game as well. Insane to me to think that a team gets five dragons and doesn't win the game.
I mean, I don't even know what the statistic is on that pastry time. The win percentage from the fifth dragon has to be massive. But if you've enjoyed this game and the series, we've had some excellent ones, especially those last two. Once the Swain came out, I knew it was going to be a good night. But if you want to keep up with the OPL, go to oce.lolesports.com. On that website, you can find the schedule, you can find the results, and see how the table is shaping up. And go back and watch that VOD, especially of the Swain game if you haven't, because it's a treat to behold.
It was great. Crazy to think that one dragon Avant got very early probably paid pretty large dividends there at the end of that game. That was a pretty value dragon.
The word of the day was definitely multiplicative. And when you're sitting at a late game Jax position, when you're that Sivir who was kind of the secret damage threat, doing so much damage with everyone focusing on the Jax, the 6% was massive.
And of course, it's been a great day, so which means you absolutely shouldn't miss day two. Let's have a look at the schedule coming up as we move into round two, day two here. Over on Monday, 6 p.m. Australian Eastern Daylight Time, we'll have the Chiefs versus Fortnite as the first game, and a massive one there to kick off, I believe, the current 1-2, at least after the first week. Direwolves versus Chiefs should be nuts.
They're the only two undefeated teams, so you definitely have to catch that second game. But the action doesn't stop there, as Fortnite, who have struggled really in their first two showings, take on the Rich Gang, who are trying to come back from that defeat to immunity. And we finish it off with Rich Gang against the Direwolves.
Yeah, so it's going to be another great day of OPL when it rolls around. It's been a fantastic day as well. So we'll see you next day. So of course, don't forget LPL's this weekend as well, starting Friday, 4 p.m. Australian Eastern Daylight Time. If you want to catch that as well, for myself, Papa Smith, the Atlas, and our entire live productions crew, it's been awesome. We'll see you later.